Have you ever wondered, as a student, that why you did not get a very good mentor? Why somebody else has such a nice mentor who's very knowledgeable, who's very bright, who's very enterprising, very supportive, whereas your mentor is a khadus? Every time it feels, you know, it's like the grass is greener on the other side. Anybody else's mentor looks good to you. Or he's a snob, he's very cruel. Same way, have you ever wondered why your mentor does not have anything good to say about you, does not encourage you, does not say, you know, good things about you, does not, you know, help you in your career? If that is so, you don't have a mentor, you have an unmentor. So unmentor is a person who actually gives a negative mentoring. We have heard a lot about mentoring in, you know, in institutions and colleges, but unmentoring is another phenomena. So what would we consider as an unmentor? Unmentor is a person who, instead of encouraging a student or a person in their career, instead of helping them develop, helping them evolve and transcend, actually puts them down or dissuades them, discourages them, demotivates them. The bottom line is, he doesn't like you. Okay? So in today's few minutes that I would talk about unmentors and unmentoring, I'm going to refer to both the mentee and mentor as he. You know, just to, you know, avoid the confusion of every time I have to say he, she, and he, she. So instead of that, I would say he as a mentor and he is the mentee, but it could be either gender. So there are unmentors all around. So who becomes an unmentor? Actually, anyone can be an unmentor. Let's look at it. There are no formal teaching or courses in mentoring. People learn from what they have seen their own mentors do, and that is what is passed on from generation to generation of students. So anyone can be unmentor. But who, why does one become an unmentor? That is a very, you know, interesting question. And as a psychiatrist, I was wondering about this point. I mean, it's that now I have come to share this, but in my 40 years of teaching, and I've seen many mentors and many mentees, I've been wondering, why are some people providing negative mentoring or they are unmentoring? And I try to look at, you know, from a Freudian psychodynamic view, psychoanalytic view, is it, you know, like the conflict that they have with their parents or the conflict that they had with their children? And a Freudian psychoanalysis is very difficult to talk about. Or is it a learned behavior? They have seen other people doing negative mentoring and they also do negative mentoring. Or is it out of jealousy, out of selfishness? But I think the bottom line is, mentoring is a difficult task. Mentoring requires a lot of energy. Unmentoring is easy. So maybe that is why people want to give negative mentoring. Now, when you look at your own colleagues and compatriots, and I have seen so many mentors and mentees, I think there are many types of unmentors. Okay? And first is a reluctant unmentor. A reluctant unmentor is one who has no skill of mentoring, who actually does not want to mentor, but has to mentor because you are in an institute and you are a faculty and you are supposed to mentor some students, whether you are interested or not. So they will very reluctantly take up the job. Another type is, the second type is a casual unmentor. A casual unmentor actually wants to mentor. Wants to become a mentor, doesn't want to mentor, but wants to become a mentor so that they can put on their resume or CV, you know, I have got so many PhDs, I have got so many postdocs, but they're not interested in actually mentoring. Not from their core heart. The third is a deliberate unmentor. A deliberate unmentor is the actual unmentor. Deliberate unmentor is the tormentor. And that is because they get joy in unmentoring. They get joy in giving trouble. They feel so good when they see their mentee squirming and, you know, feeling very troubled. So that is the deliberate unmentor. Then we have the competitive unmentor. A competitive unmentor is having competition with other mentors. I want to have more students. I want to have more postdocs. Okay? They feel very insecure. So it is a part of their insecurity that they want to mentor more and more. And it's a competitive. But in that competition and in that insecurity, sometimes they are also insecure. What if my mentee becomes better than me? That is possible. Okay? So, see, this is different from, many times we think a mentor and a mentee is like a parent and a child. A parent always feels good if the child does better than them. But a competitive mentor will not feel that way. If they think their mentee has outshone them or they outshine them, they feel very bad. Then we have the all-powerful mentor. This is the traditional mentor. All-powerful mentor is who wants the mentee to be totally dependent on them. For everything, they should come to them. And then they start using them. They use them as an aide, actually a slave. And they use them like a servant. So they want, you are going to the library, why don't you take my books and return them there? Why don't you, you are going there, why don't you? Then it moves on. Why don't you get some milk also, an egg also, you know? So a mentee is like a shishya, so does everything. Then we have, nowadays, this generation is gone off, is the pseudo-unmentor. Okay, so there is a double negative here. Pseudo and mentor is a mentor, actually, of our generation. So they actually want to do good in the long run. So when I was young, we used to get, teachers who would first come and give us one slap, then they will talk to us when, they will hit us with a scale. If we have not done anything, the scale is a flat scale. If we have done something, it used to be a straight scale on the knuckles. I also remember, one of the mentors or a teacher who would teach consider his postgraduates very, very harshly. He would curse them. He would use bad words for them. He would say, I will throw you from here, throw you from there. But actually, he did that for their good. And even the students felt that, they never felt bad about him. They always respected him. They always came back and said, sir or madam, if you had not been so strict, I would not have been there. So this is a pseudo unmentor, but actually this is a tribe which is becoming less and less. Nowadays, you can't do all these things in educational institutions. So how is negative mentoring done? Like I said, it is very easy to do negative mentoring. One way of doing negative mentoring is don't give. For the mentor, don't give. Don't give advice, don't give suggestion, don't give proper direction. Biggest thing is don't give time. Whenever they ask, come tomorrow, come next week, take an appointment. And when they come for that appointment, you give them another appointment. Don't be available. If you are not available as a mentor, mentee has very little to do. Plus, humiliate the person, demotivate the person. It's very easy to do. Ask them very difficult question when you have a group of students. This person doesn't know the answer. So that is a way of humiliation of the person. So giving negative feedback instead of showing them how to improve, telling them, points which will actually make them even worse. So with all this negative mentoring, actually what happens to the mentee? Now the mentee is also now become an unmentee. isn't it? What happens to them? They're totally shattered. They break down. And, you know, often we find, you know, in the news that in IITs or engineering colleges or medical colleges, you know, some student has harmed themselves or made an attempt or, you know, all sorts of things because they break down. There are some others who actually use unhealthy methods like smoking, drinking, taking drugs in order to cope with this stress. So this is an additional stress for the unmentee. Some others are a little more clever. They forget their mentor and then they start going to other mentors who are actually not their mentors, you know, so that they can take help from them, so they could go to them. Or, so these are various negative ways. There are some others who would probably use a much more positive way of coping with unmentoring. And that is, they take it as an opportunity to work harder even without the mentor. And they become more resilient, they become strong, they become a much more self-made person. They always feel that if some things go wrong, then you can always blame the mentor. If you do something good, the credit goes to the mentor. But if you're not getting any mentoring, then you yourself have to take the blame or the credit of what you are doing. There are two ways how an unmentee can know that they are getting negative mentoring. One is, they have to identify, they have to compare with other students. Well, other students are getting more time with their mentors, they are very supportive, you know, they are, you know, involving them in research, in papers, in presentations, and doing various things for their career. Whereas mine is not doing. So you identify that I am getting negative mentoring or I am being unmentored. And second is that if you realize that your mentor doesn't like you, or the mentor realizes that the mentee doesn't like him, if there is a dislike, then there is a high chance that negative mentoring is going on. But you should still be lucky if you are only having negative mentoring and not having dismentoring. Dismentoring is actually even more pathological. In dismentoring, the mentor actually teaches the mentee wrong things. How to cheat, how to do cut and paste and write a paper, how to avoid work, how to be corrupt, how to fake data, how to do various sorts of things that they would like to encourage them to do. That is dismentoring, at least that is not there. Then there are some proxy mentors. They will not mentor directly. They will ask their junior to mentor the mentee, you know. So, but that is not as bad because the junior mentor also wants to learn. So there are advantages of being unmentored and advantages of being, you know, getting negative mentoring because you become a self-made person. You can always be proud of yourself, what you did. You know, you have risen in your life without a godfather. Okay. So one of the barriers for mentorship is people are scared that whether I will get a good mentor or a bad mentor, whether I get a good mentoring or a positive mentoring or a negative mentoring. That scares people in seeking a mentor. In this competitive world, it's very sad. There is dementorization also, which is that the value of mentoring is coming down more and more. Of course, you would have guess that why I came up with this idea was that I have gone through a lot of this. Not only that, when I became a teacher the last 30, 40 years, I never realized that I was doing a lot of negative mentoring. I was not being harsh or punitive, but I used to use a lot of sarcasm. I was very skeptic. I would, make fun of my students and all. And then, how did I change it? In these days when there are emails and WhatsApp and things like these, my students wrote to me, "Sir, because of you, I am getting affected." And that changed me. Now I don't make fun at others, I just make fun at myself, so in order to not hurt them. Mentoring is like a relationship. Unmentoring is like a toxic relationship. In mentoring, there is a actual, in a relationship, there is a give and take. Ideally, you know, whether it happens or not, it's a different issue, but we expect there should be a good equal give and take. In mentoring, it is that the guru or the mentor will give without any bias, all the knowledge that they have, and the mentee will receive. In unmentoring, that doesn't happen. That reminds me of a doha by Kabir. Guru Kumar Shishya Kumbh hai. Guru Kumar Shishya Kumbh hai. Thap thap mare thoe andar se haath de ke bahar bahe the. Which is that guru is a potter or a potter man, and the student is the pot which is being shaped by the guru. So it is actually an ideal situation where the guru is supporting from inside the clay and, you know, pounding from outside to give it a shape. In unmentoring, what will happen? The inside support is not there, so the student is misshaped, or the outside one is so hard that it hurts the child. So in these days, we find actually much more negative mentoring than mentoring. So in the end, I would like to wish and say that if you getting a good mentor or a bad mentor is actually your karma and your luck. Okay, if you get a positive mentor, it is good. But if you get a negative mentor, it is even better, because that will make you a self-made person. And if you get both, then probably you're very lucky. And I wish that you get good mentoring, if not from the mentors, from life. Thank you very much.